Winifred, a Welsh saint from the 7th century. So we're back kind of in the same kind of neighborhood as Sed and Chad and Hilda and Wilfred and Cuthbert and all those folks. Anyone who's a fan of the Brother Cadfael series by Ellis Peters or the fantastic television program where Cadfael is played by Derek Jacobi should be familiar with Saint Winifred. Now, her story is pretty similar to a lot of other saints kind of around the same time. She's the daughter of a Welsh chieftain, and her uncle is a monk, a holy person named Buno. He's important. We'll see him in a bit. Also regarded as a saint. So Winifred decides that she wants to become a nun and kind of get out of the whole court thing. Now, her boyfriend, her betrothed, is a guy named Caradoc. He does not like that at all. So he does what everyone would do in those circumstances. He cuts off her head, and her head goes flying and lands, and there a holy well springs up. Now, her uncle, the saint, comes to her. I guess he was sort of in the neighborhood. That's a little bit perplexing to me. He comes and he puts her head back on her and he prays for her and she is restored back to life. Then he looks over and he sees Caradoc kind of leaning on his sword, being all cocky that he kind of got away with something. And he prays to heaven that he would be punished, and heaven punishes him. And the ground opens up and swallows him up like Dathan. And then Buno sets down on a stone and he said that whoever would on that spot would ask for God's benefit three times in the name of Saint Winifred would obtain the grace if he asked if it was good for his soul. And that's the holy well. So Winifred goes on to found a convent and become an abbess and live kind of a long holy life. And soon after her death, the local church acclaims her as a saint. Now, her relics ended up in Shrewsbury, which is a city not too far away. Now, on account of her story, Winifred's prayers are often requested to protect people, especially women, from unwanted advances. So Winifred is kind of a patron saint of the Me Too movement and a good person to have in your corner. When I went to the Holy Well of St. Winifred, it's currently a pilgrimage site administered by the Roman Catholic Diocese of Wrexham. And they bill themselves as the Lords of Wales, which I think is great. It's just fantastic. Now, the shrine is kind of, or the Holy Well, I should say, is kind of cut into the side of a steep, curved, almost cliff. And the building, I think, is from like the 15th century. The veneration of Winifred on this site dates to at least the 12th century and possibly earlier. The Holy Well, Winifred's Holy Well, is actually mentioned in the Anglo-Saxon poem Sir Gawain and the Green Knight, and that's from the 14th century. So again, it's a popular pilgrimage site. A bunch of kings have actually come here. Richard I went there before his crusade. Henry V supposedly walked there from Shrewsbury, which would be about a 17 or an 18-hour walk. James II came there to pray that his wife would be able to get pregnant. And even Queen Victoria, when she was still a princess, made a visit there. When I came, it was actually the opening day of the pilgrimage season. A guy working there told me there was going to be an outdoor mass, and then they were going to bless the holy well and sprinkle everybody with water, and then there would actually be a veneration of the relic of St. Winifred. It was sort of a simple outdoor mass. The priest, I think, was Italian. He had kind of a fairly thick accent. There were bunches of kids running around. There were a bunch of kind of men off in one corner having a completely separate conversation. And the priest was totally irritated with them. It was clearly they were being really distracting. He kept looking over at them. Someone actually had to go over and shush him at one time. After the prayers of the people, the priest then kind of blessed the well they're actually regular bathing times, so you can actually kind of go down into the well, and then he sprinkled everybody. And then after the Mass, he went back into the kind of the shrine itself, and then we all kind of filed in to venerate the relic of St. Winifred. Okay, so we need to talk a little bit about relics. So particularly in the Episcopal Church, relics are not something we really talk about much. And for somebody as old as St. Winifred, we're talking about the 7th century, one question we might have is, you know, is this really her? And we don't know for sure. There are some very old fragments, probably from an 8th century reliquary. So it's possible that her relics were preserved there. Whatever those relics were, they were moved to Shrewsbury in 1138. Now, the shrine stayed there until the dissolution of the monasteries. And so at that time, in a lot of these shrines, folks would kind of grab the relics, before the soldiers come in to destroy the church and the shrine. So it's entirely possible, and considering how risky it was to be a Catholic, and to do something like that would have been bad. So they're taking a real risk to do that. So again, I don't entirely know. More importantly, I don't know how much it matters. The relics really serve to remind us that these saints were real people like us. That whole afternoon, I found myself thinking about Winifred as the patron of those receiving unwanted advances. In a time when we're wrestling kind of deeply with sexual harassment and toxic masculinity, we have this figure of Saint Winifred. And in the story, she is assaulted, and God brings her back to life. That's an incredibly powerful image for all the women and everyone who struggle with the aftermath of sexual harassment and violence. It's interesting, people and sins and grace and God don't really change all that much. It's just the circumstances. So it was fantastic to be there for the opening of the pilgrimage season at the well. And I hope and pray that God gives everyone who goes to the well the healing that they need.